running SNC for a while now. And one of the things you do at SNC is to make sure the startups are doing that shit before they can roll out. And UX has been a core part, and you've been conducting trainings, you've been inviting people to come in, you know, give talks. So what is the sort of big deficiency you find in this Pakistani landscape which you think could be filled either by industry or by academia? Then you might be able to sell these startups in a much better way if there's any.
I think probably the biggest deficiency is good HR in this field, whereas they understand individuals' experience. We often struggle to find people who can get it and who want to get it, and additionally, not only get it, but are able to explain and articulate it and teach others. So that has been one of the biggest pain points in this regard. From the LC experience. So, initiatives like this can go a lot towards getting awareness of the UX and then the size of the service as something that they can share on and eventually be able to share it with others.
Audience, is that when you're a big company, the kind of challenges you would face from an experience perspective would be different, but when you start a new company, and you sort of want to run a good show, the kind of challenges you would face are completely different. So can you sort of highlight the kind of the more interesting challenges you face while building the product, both from a product perspective and also from a digital design perspective?
I think building on what Khurram said, just continuing to follow and ask a specific question that you said, I think the reason we lag in terms of HR is both in the product front and the UI front is that at some point in our history as a nation, we stopped innovating and we stopped making products. And I think, I'm not going to go into the politics of that, but I mean, it really is critical because I actually interact with a lot of people who have 30, 40 years in product design because we actually do a physical product design. And the seminal or the moment that pivoted this country away from innovation was literally, the government at some point in whether it was 74 or 75 had decided to nationalize everything. Before that, there was a lot of innovation happening in Pakistan. I mean, it's literally till that point there were people who in those days were making hundreds of thousands of rupees because they were good designers. And then suddenly everything stopped. And the reason I say that is that good design comes later. You start to make stuff, and of course there's a lot of innovation happening in the software side, it's easier. But first you make stuff and then you improve it, right? I first make a car and then, initially it will look ugly and then I'll redesign it and the next model will be nicer and it will be much nicer and then, that goes along with sort of the iterative process that you go through in a good design anyway, right? So I think that is, one thing we need to do is just need to start making products, right? I think that's what LC is doing and that's what we're doing. I think just because of the necessity of, good design, eventually you will develop that HR. But one of the things that I would really have liked to see in this country is that maybe Lungs can do this is have a design school. I mean, there's just no design school in Pakistan. I mean, how many people have a degree in industrial design, for example, or how many graduates we have in UX design, for example, right? And that's an area we really, really need to focus on. In terms of my challenges as a small company, I think the biggest challenge is, really make the small device, which is a gas-saving device, it's called gel voice, something you might know about. A good part of that is actually a physical product, right? Another thing that we learned was that a small company, rapid prototyping of a physical product is very difficult to understand, right? I mean, when we started, 3D printers were sort of coming out, but even if the 3D printers were available, the kind of work we do, it only partly benefited from the 3D printers, but, not even 3D printers are slowly banned. banned in this country. So, but I think just a lot of rapid prototyping for physical products is something that's needed, and I think we literally won't find a place in Pakistan where you can. So I can find a place where I can get some plastic part made and some, you know, machine parts made under one roof in Pakistan. There are bits, and I mean there's some wonderful work being done. Sorry, I'm taking a little longer, but let me and stop me if I do, but you know, we have gone through some really interesting experiences. There's some really wonderful people doing some wonderful work. I mean, there's a person in Pakistan who actually does machining for heart valves right here in Pakistan. I mean, we found a person who actually turns tungsten into parts that go into limbs. I mean, he works with, you know, a couple of big name surgeons in Lahore, and it's much more cost effective to do that work in Pakistan than to import those, because those need to be custom made. So there's some extremely, you know, interesting work being done in Pakistan, but somehow we haven't been able to sort of, you know, bring it together and organize as a country and you know, make an industry out of it, which is essentially industrial design. And the final thing is that we actually started working with a couple of, I mean, we developed this capacity of actually building digital products. Another thing that we found out was that there's not as much appreciation of good design in terms of people even compensating you appropriately. Flow कहते हैं कि ये कह दिया आपने जो squiggly lines draw करती हैं यहाँ पर logo बन गया और आप कहते हैं कि ये से 2 lakh का देते हैं. Right. Yeah. So along the same line, हम लोग छोटा सा किसी ने part बनाया जिसके ऊपर हमारे 2 हफ्ते लग गए कि क्या ये तो मैं 2 दिन में बन जाएगा. जी हमने जब बना लिया है तो अब तो आप इसको 2 दिन में बना लेंगे, इसलिए कि आपको एग्जैक्टली पता लग गया कैसे क्या डिजाइन है. लेकिन इनिशियली जब ये बना नहीं था, जब फर्स्ट कॉपी दैट इट वाज बीइंग मेड एंड द प्रोसेस दैट वी हैड टू गो थ्रू एंड द काइंड ऑफ यू नो बैकग्राउंड वी नीडेड टू हैव years of experience and work. So to answer your question, there's a lot of challenges. I hope somebody opens a design school in Pakistan. I hope, you know, this community gets organized. And I think, I think this is a great effort, but I think, you know, UX design is the starting point, but eventually we need to go to product design and industry design also. So I hope that happens.
No, we agree. I mean, lots of do that. So hopefully, I think we'll step in. So, thank you very much. For you, I was wondering, so you get great talk on enterprise, but I think if you take this perspective from CSR as an enterprise, you know, corporate social responsibility, do you think as an enterprise you can give back to academia or society or startups in terms of UX?
You can.
For me? Yeah.
Yes.
And as corporation officers. Can it go also in the CSR that, you know, you have to promote this thing in academia, in industry, in schools?
Well, I can't speak on behalf of in visual capacity, but definitely in personal capacity. I don't think there's anyone stopping anyone who work in any company, to take on that social responsibility. I think as responsible citizens, if we see any deficiency in our society, whatever that may be, I think it's we should all contribute in whatever manner we can. So I'm personally for it, and I'm, like I said before, I'm really happy. It's hard to see when we have this forum, and hopefully so we can be better than. So I'm going to be after you now.
Thank you. Farah, so you and me are from academia, and you know, we love to teach, and that's what we're sitting here. But from a business perspective, from a marketing perspective, you know, how, what are the challenges, for example, this business strategy and your strategy is merging? We can see that you're just getting the pot. What is the starting point? How can we start?
Yeah, before I move to business strategy, I really want to highlight just very good amount of nature, and it's very much related to the comment of See, designer is an artist, and there are two critical elements of an artist. A, artist has to be patient. Patience is good for any artist. Second, the artist gets inspiration from the surroundings. Now we are talking about young people, and Khurram rightly pointed out we don't have resources, but my problem is different. It seems we might development source, you might ask somebody to come from abroad and teach us, but what about these two critical elements of an artist? A, you are guys are not, you don't show patience. You don't want to do multiple iterations of your prototype. So yeah, yesterday you thought of a product and today you want it to be a mega success. It's not going to happen. So we have to change our mindset first. And the second thing is, what about the surroundings? So if you will spend all your days and nights in the bedroom and in lounges, and you don't go outside the lounge, so how would you develop inspiration? So I think these are the first two things. And so this is what we have started doing in our business school. We force our students to get out of lounges, because lounges is a bubble that you are living in. And please go out and experience the real world, which is definitely outside the kitchen and home. So this is the first thing we have started doing. Now coming back to business, because the nature of the business has been changing. And one of the guest speakers today showed us a slide, and I think that is this slide, where he said that we are now selling experiences. And all the businesses are selling experiences. So I can give you a few examples to develop a context here. So for example, the banking sector is really worried about it, that we will become irrelevant in a few years to come, within a few years, because the lousy experience that we are generating in our outlet is no more relevant to the users. So now they have to rethink about their business engagement with consumers. So their model will be changed, the business model will be disrupted soon. So I can assure you, you will see a lot of disruption in the banking sector in Pakistan. Now, academia is also changing. We have already, we have done one experiment with our Lux and Lux program, and I assure you, after a few years' time, students would not, they will definitely don't want to come to universities if universities won't change the user experience. There are a lot of education there online. It is the only degree that now students come to university. Believe me, not for the knowledge, because knowledge is there available on Google and online resources. So academia has to rethink about the experience that we are generating within the four walls. So when I say user experience, and of course, if my customer is not interested in getting the services and buying the products that I'm selling, so my business model is no more relevant. So your question that how user experience is impacting the business world, it is impacting like anything. Different companies, even in Pakistan, belonging to different sectors, they have already started thinking of evolving user experience. And as you evolve the user experience, you have to then change your business model as well. So exciting stuff is happening out there. My 2 cents would be, please develop some patience for iterations and prototypes and start getting the inspiration from the surroundings. Why? Because good HR will be required by these companies. So they might not engage you because you are a LAMS graduate. They will definitely look into that element to what extent you are a designer. Thank you.
Thank you. So I came to my favorite question. Well, as Dr. Farah mentioned, designer is an artist. So one thing you see very often in design is that you have this beautiful concept which you want to present and want to make, and you have this great idea, but it doesn't translate into engineering terms. You know, so you have your engineering challenges. You can make a great page, it doesn't work, which doesn't process information. So how, from a clean perspective, you know, how do you handle that challenge? You know, how do you train the designers to think as engineers? And ask our engineers to think of the designers very often to go to school and get married, you know, get things out. How do you do that?
Right, so I think that one simple answer to that is that we make the designers work very closely with the engineers. We have an organizational model where we have designers, product managers, and a lot of other business folks, as well as the engineers, both the front-end engineers and the back-end engineers, embedded in the same teams. We call them cross-functional teams. It's not very traditional. Normally, the development model that is followed in a lot of companies is that you have engineering organization, you have QA organization, you have UX design and product and so on. So better collaboration or closer collaboration is one of the things where, for instance, the designers may be advocating for designers and product managers are advocating on the user's behalf, and engineers are advocating on behalf of engineering simplicity or reducing the complexity. But I think that part of the answer or the untraditional answer would be that we also need to inject more rigor that comes typically from science or engineering into design as well. So there is the artist aspect of engineering design, but now the design process has also been systematized, or methodologies have been created to the point, toolings and techniques are available where you don't have to just argue in terms of the subjective sense of the experience, but also you can actually show it through data. So the proof is in the pudding. If you can actually show the value of something through data, and we use a lot of those techniques. We do a lot of A/B testing, and we use mixed panel and analytic, Google Analytics and other tooling to actually see where we lose our customers and how the conversion is happening and what are the places where things can be improved. So I think that the data is a key thing there also. And today there were some really awesome talks, but one geek that I have with a lot of them was that a lot of folks said that there is no correct answer. So in light of what I just said, I do think that there are right answers even in user experience design. We just have to use the right tooling for it. And also it depends on what objective you're trying to achieve. If you can define the problem in a more constrained manner, such that there is an objective, then you can actually show what the right answer is to those problems.
I fully agree on this. There are measures which can take. There's an ROI, and that's measurable. For example, Farah teaches the course also data-driven. She's one of that. I think data is the key nowadays. Data is actually telling us, it shows the path. But I think again, I do have my reservations that if we get too data-centric, we also lose the subjective part, and experience part of each. So there's this tension out there, there's a conflict out there, that balance that balance. So you can't be too data-driven. Sort of the Google approach just started with, they were just an engineering company focusing on data. They were very much functioning, but they're not doing any of those statics and subjective. And then they realize it, and now when you look at Google now, the material design and the new design, the fact that the design is used, it's a different Google now. So, they have taken a different approach because they knew as an engineering company, they're not doing that which is used. So I think there's lots of potential there.
No, totally agree. Yeah. There's a reason that the way users characterize Google versus Apple, there is a clear distinction. But of course, the companies or products that people associate a lot of warmth with, I would say Facebook included, some people might disagree, and Apple, they are also building, in fact, Facebook has some of the best tooling in terms of A/B testing. So they A/B test the hell out of pretty much everything, including the changes of color, shape of colors, and so on. So, but I agree that it has to be balanced. Yeah.
So now we'll open the floor to the public to sort of go into the discussion and feel free to ask questions. Yeah.
Thanks for the comments. I have a comment on the last point that you just said, and that about the right answer. And I would sort of blame a certain thought process that we have both as scientists and engineers, that we have thought about convergent thinking. And if you reflect back at the courses and the trainings that we take, there is always a right answer. We give you a set of problems and we want you to get to a particular solution. And I'm not commenting on things outside of science and engineering because I don't know much about them. I know as I'm a physicist myself. But this convergent thinking is something that is trained throughout our educational experience. But what I truly believe is that when you are trying to understand and solve problems, what has to happen is something along the lines of a divergent thinking. Because getting to this one particular solution is, I think, much more restrictive in a sense. And there has to be some sort of a rebellion the way we conduct engineering and science education. And to that one particular point, because even our assessment mechanisms are also checking for that one right answer. So I think the whole UX experience is trying to identify what's the next better way to do it, right? And this process of reiteration again and again and getting towards the best or the next best experience is something I think which lies at the very heart of what we try to do and not to get to that one right answer, because I don't believe there is one right answer.
So I knew that this point would be very controversial. So I'll be brief because I also want to give others the opportunity to maybe address that as well. I agree that that you know some part of this, that even if there is a right answer, how are you going to get to it? Because if wherever you are, you may actually be in a local maxima. And in order to achieve the global maxima, in order to, you need some lateral thinking or divergent thinking. So you don't exactly know what the right answer is. You need tools and techniques to get there. And things that foster creativity, including divergent thinking, lateral thinking, creativity exercises, they are means to actually get you out of the little hole or well that you might be inside and help you achieve that ultimately the answer that is going to delight your users.
That's number one. And I think you can create fuzzy situations where
maybe multiple answers are correct. And even in engineering, for example, मैं आपको बहुत mundane सी चीज बता सकता हूँ. Let's say you want to give somebody a question on transformer design. थोड़ा सा transformer लगाता है voltages को 220 से 10 volt में convert करने के लिए बता सकता है. या engineer voltage. Even उसके अंदर आप बड़े creative question पूछ सकते हैं. Maybe you can arrive at multiple answers, you know, for the same question. So I think the faculty needs to sort of, you know, get into that mode where they start to ask questions in a way that, you know, students can be more creative with their answers. So I think, you know, that's, there was something else I wanted to talk about, but I lost my train of thought. But I think that the final thing that I think where, you know, there is an opportunity to really teach creativity to students and think out of the box is, I don't know about lungs, but when I was going to an Indian university, Harvard, you said this thing called final year project. मेरे पास एक बच्ची आई, मेरे दोस्त की बेटी थी, मेरे पास आई last year, कहती है जी, अंकल बताएं मैंने project करना है, तो मुझे कोई project बताएं. मैं उसको बड़े दो छोटे छोटे project बताए, और मैं भी आपको project बता भी देता हूँ, मैंने उससे क्या बताया. कहती है, अंकल मजा नहीं आया. अंकल क्या हुआ? नहीं, वो मेरा फलान क्लास वाला है, वो एक रोबोट कह रहा है, वो पता नहीं क्या करेगा, और यू नो वो बॉल फेंकेगा और पता नहीं, यू नो सम रियली यू नो आउट ऑफ दिस वर्ल्ड टाइप. और मैंने उसको क्या कहा था करने के लिए, मैंने कहा देखो पाकिस्तान में छोटी सी प्रॉब्लम है, आई बीन ट्राइंग टू सॉल्व इट. वो ये है कि सर्दियों में बहुत सारी डेथ्स होती हैं, इसलिए हमारे घरों में वो गैस डिटेक्टर नहीं होता. हमारी अप्लायंसेज हैं वो जब लोड शेडिंग होती है दोबारा गैस आती है तो वो शट ऑफ नहीं करती अपने आप को, तो लोग मर जाते हैं क्योंकि गैस इनहेल करते हैं, मर जाते हैं. तो आप एक लो पास डिटेक्टर बना लो. कहते हैं ये तो बड़ा सादा सा सर्किट होता है और ये तो बन जाएगा, ये तो एक हफ्ते का प्रोजेक्ट है. मैंने कहा बेटा ये एक हफ्ते का प्रोजेक्ट नहीं है. व्हाट आई वांट यू टू डू इज टू टेक इट टू अ पॉइंट वेयर यू हैव डन द कॉस्टिंग, यू हैव डन द रनिंग अराउंड एंड यू हैव ब्रॉट इट डाउन टू 200 रुपीस अ पॉप सो दैट एवरी पाकिस्तानी कैन एक्चुअली बाय वन. And I want you to go through all of this process. And not only that, I want you to go through all of this process, I want you to create a user manual for it. I want you to package it for it. And you need to, when you come to the final year project presentation, aap mere samne ek dabba rakhogi, jisko main kholunga, uske andar ye cheez niklegi, aur ye cheez is stage pe hogi ki ye actually totally commercializable hai, aur isko main, I can put it out there, and this is actually a real world solution. Right? But I think another thing that we want to, you know, bring down our end to end बच्चों को problem solve करना सिखाना चाहिए. Yeah, that you know the simple problems हैं बच्चों को, but let them complete it from A to Z. Not के लिए बस कि आपने उसका एक 20% बना दिया है, main algorithm बना दिया है, you know खलाई आपने चीज छोटा सा जहाज बना लिया जो मरीज में जाके वहां से माइन करके पता नहीं क्या बोर्ड उठा के ले आएगा या मिटा के उसका के माइन प्रोजेक्ट. But I think, you know, the whole approach, you know, the way we give problems, you know, to our students, and, you know, this is some sort of long sort of, you know, answer, but I think, you know, there are ways we can improve creativity in the education process.
One last question, because we're going to have time. Next time, we'll go back to
office. I was having a question regarding the same,
there's
no right
and
wrong
answer. Hijacked
idea.
It was all on purpose.
Yeah, it was all on
purpose. I just want to say one thing, though. This was a very awesome story, but I'm never coming to you for advice on this project. It's going to last forever.
So, again, back to that same comment, that is, there is not a single right or wrong answer. So, if we cannot have a right or wrong answer, can we have some sort of, first of all, heuristics at the time of design, so that we can follow the best practices in order to achieve the better design that would be acceptable, that would be in the list of the right answers and not the wrong answers? And at the time of evaluation, can we have some sort of evaluation criteria which can mark that this is an acceptable area or this is a total wrong design? So I think if we can use this as right answer or the wrong answer, there is no single right answer. But again, can we mark an area? That is, if these are the characteristics which are being achieved, then this would lead to a right answer. And if these characteristics are not met, then it would lead to the wrong solution. So there
could
be a framework, I think, which can help.
Right, so one thing I mentioned was A/B testing or getting the data. So you have to have a hypothesis, and then you want to get data and prove that hypothesis. But the primary reason I mentioned that thing was, one, when you are building products as opposed to when you are creating art, you also have to inject some pragmatics into it. You have to be able to decide on things. You cannot just keep talking about it and, you know, just apply subjectivity. So you have to have a way of resolving those discussions and then move on and do something. And then defer those questions, like, you know, ultimately showing what is better, to the next increment or next iteration. And I think you were hinting at that as well. So that was my primary reason for putting it out there. The other thing was that user experience design lies somewhere between rigorous engineering and art. And I don't think that we should always be saying that anything can be right there, because things have changed in recent years while the industry is approaching art design.
Yeah, so the good news is that
Arif
is a lifelong learner, and he's very stable product, which is called Lums MBA. So we really believe in innovation. And I request you, when you will meet today on the first floor, there are like about 9 semis displaying there, our MBA 2018 projects. And they are not the projects, we are calling them, they're my startups. So what we have done in the last semester, in the second semester of Lums MBA 2018, we have given them 50,000 rupees as an interest-free loan. It is not just 50,000 rupees for free. It's interest-free loan, which they have to return, by the way, to us by first week of June this year. So the whole idea was, there is some money to test your creativity. If there is a designer hidden in you, please bring your designer out. So I think, given a time constraint, and I remember when we were testing this idea with alumni, most of the alumni told us this is not possible. How can they do this? You're asking them to churn profits, because one of the charities is expressing it. I think just have faith in these young people. And interestingly, after launching their prototypes, some of the groups have already started making money. And here comes the real thing. Some of the senior faculty members, you know, they challenged us, ki aap kya karenge, hamare lungs and ye to bada zabardast kaam karna chahiye, 50,000 se to bada lungs pe kaam hoga. And again we came in and we said, just hold on, leave this creativity to them, and you never know. Because you see, you can solve these very small problems, which are actually the genuine problems, and here comes innovation, right? So just don't ask people to do big projects. They can also done some breakthroughs through small projects. Going back to your question that how will we evaluate, you know, the user experience or the design or the success of the project. Very quickly, if I can make a comment on it. So how we are evaluating these entrepreneurial ventures of our MBA students? There are only 3 criteria. A, they should show us good return on investment. Although we have given them 50,000 rupees, there is one company that they have, not the company, their startup, where they have invested only 6,000 rupees and already have made like about 90,000 rupees. What kind of interesting business model it is? So this is like return on investment. The second thing is scalability. You don't want to, you know, spend your energies on such designs which are not scalable. Right? So please be very careful. Whatever you do, it needs to be scalable. Can you really take it to the next level? Paise banenge ki bhi, by the end of the day, you have to make money. You need sustainability. The third variable that we have put in is the innovation. To what extent it is innovative? Mere tarah se aap gol gappe jaake dekhte hain, but are you selling gol gappe in an innovative way? You see, so this is the way you can push young people towards this dimension of creativity and innovation. There is no easy answer to it. But yes, we have to start the journey. So the good news is that Lums MBA has now started their journey. Let's see how it will end this first week. This would be specific.
This is part of, yeah, exactly. And, oh yes, and they already know about it. And by the way, the faculty won't judge it. So we will have a conference like in the first week of June, and we will invite panelists, and they will judge their projects.
So we really have to finish today. I was hoping that these
interviews would be done in
So we're going to wrap it up today. We have a very nice cake for you. It's Pakistan's we're going to cut today. It's an inaugural conference. I think it was also a gift for us. And then we have some small ceremony. We're going to give the cheese to all the participants. Where is cheese? Sorry. Cheese. Gentlemen, please, thanks. Thank you very much.